advised.
Child abuse is when a parent or caregiver, whether through action or failing to act, causes injury, death, emotional harm, or risk of serious harm to a child. There are many forms of child maltreatment, including neglect, physical abuse, sexual abuse, exploitation, and emotional abuse. The murder of baby Brianna is considered one of the worst cases of child abuse in U.S. history. Brianna Lopez, who is also known to many as Baby Brianna, was a baby girl who was born in New Mexico Hospital on Valentine's Day 2002. To her mother, Stephanie Lopez, and to her father, Andy Walters. She would have turned 19 years old on February 14, 2021, but sadly, she never made it. When baby Brianna left the hospital after her birth, she moved into a home in Las Cruces, New Mexico, shared by her parents and Uncle Steve Lopez. The abuse almost started immediately. Instead of hugs and kisses, Brianna received slaps and pinches. She was tormented on a daily basis, both verbally and physically. She was slapped, kicked, punched, pinched, thrown, raped, etc. You name it, this infant endured it. When Brianna would cry at the pain that was inflicted on her, her abusers would laugh and stuff her mouth with clothing to muffle her screams. Her own mother would bite and pinch her when she got frustrated by the crying. But for the most part, it was the infant's father and uncle who tormented her while Stephanie sat back and ignored her daughter's cries. Medical examiners would later report the marks as being both old and new, which proved prolonged abuse. Brianna also had bleeding on her brain, both old and new, as well as broken ribs, broken legs, broken arms, laceration to her fingers, vagina, and anus. Little Brianna was abused every day of her very short life by the people who were supposed to love her. Baby Brianna was what many would consider a strong baby, because she managed to survive for 153 days despite coming into the cruel world weighing only several pounds. On the evening of July 18, 2002, Andy went out to purchase beer. And when he came home, they all proceeded to get drunk. Stephanie claimed to have only had a few beers before heading to bed in the same room the others were in. During this time, both Andy and Steven decided to play their own sick, demented game where they would toss Brianna up in the air, let her hit the ceiling, and watch her tumble to the ground. They would later tell authorities that Brianna was screaming and wailing when this was happening. Apparently, the baby's mother didn't hear her daughter screaming and crying in agony. Early the next morning, on July 19, 2002, at approximately 7:15 a.m., Stephanie woke to Brianna crying and noticed fresh bruises on her and asked the others what happened. They told her they had been a little rough with her last night. She accepted their answer and ignored her child's injuries. That same morning, Stephanie noticed Brianna needed diaper change, and Andy volunteered to do it. During the diaper change, he wrapped a baby wipe around his finger and inserted it into Brianna's anus. He also sodomized her with foreign objects. When Stephanie noticed Brianna near death, she ignored it and decided to wait several hours before calling an ambulance. When she did find the time to call them, she lied and told them her daughter had fallen from her high chair. Apparently, she was delusional enough to think authorities would buy that story. Brianna was rushed to the hospital where she was pronounced dead at 11:10 a.m. The first officer to see baby Brianna in the hospital was Detective Lyndall Wright. He remembers one thought going through his mind: I've got a lot to do. She was literally bruised from head to toe, from the top of her head all throughout her body, all the way to the big toe on her right foot, said Governor Susana Martinez, who prosecuted Brianna's family. They took sadistic joy out of torturing this infant. Not one family member cared about her. Not one of them attempted to protect her. And there's zero proof to suggest she was ever shown love in her short life. She was there for their sadistic amusement. When police searched the home, they couldn't find one toy or even a photo of Brianna laughing or smiling. There was no evidence to indicate she enjoyed one moment of her life. Many relatives, including Brianna's grandparents, knew what was occurring but ignored it. They knew their granddaughter was being raped by both her father and uncle. They knew she had been pinched from head to toe, in different stages of healing. They knew she was being tormented and had marks, cuts, lacerations, but they turned a blind eye and let it continue for 5, going on 6 months until baby Brianna's little body couldn't handle the abuse any longer. Andy Walters was charged with child abuse resulting in death and criminal sexual penetration of a minor and first-degree felony. Stephanie and Steven Lopez were charged with child abuse resulting in death. The three other adults living in the home were not charged. The two other children living in the home were taken into protective custody. Shortly thereafter, two more family members were arrested in connection with Brianna's murder. Her grandmother, Patricia Walters, and her uncle, Robert Walters Jr., were both charged with failure to report child abuse or child neglect, a misdemeanor. Their trials were scheduled for September of 2003. District Judge Stephen Bridgeforth agreed to move the trial from Dona Ana County due to extensive coverage of the case. During the trial, the prosecution would argue that all five adults in the home knew about the abuse and allowed it to happen. Defense lawyers, however, suggested that their respective clients did know how the injuries were inflicted on Brianna. Some of the first witnesses to testify were the ambulance dispatcher and emergency room nurse who desperately tried to save Brianna's life. A recording of the 911 call from Stephanie was played out, during which she said that Brianna was not breathing and that she fell off the bed. The 911 operator explained how to perform CPR and check for a pulse, to which Stephanie replies with, "I can't feel anything." Nurse Yvonne Mouchette next described to the jury how Brianna came into the hospital. The bite marks and bruises across her face, head, and body were extensive. She said that it was already far too late for Brianna, and there was no way to bring her back. She described how before Stephanie was taken to the police station, she was allowed to see Brianna's body. She said that Stephanie asked to hold Brianna, and with her body in her arms, she repeatedly said, "I'm sorry." Afterwards, Stephanie asked if she could cover Brianna's bruises. She ended up covering everything except for Brianna's eyes. Detective Ed Miranda took the jury through an interview he had with Brianna's uncle Stephen following his arrest. He told the jury that Stephen had admitted to raping Brianna and throwing her up in the air and allowing her to come crashing down to the floor. He asked Stephen, "Did you have sex with baby Brianna?" To which Stephen replied with, "Yes." When speaking about how he and Annie threw Brianna up in the air, he said, "We were just playing with her." His testimony was followed by some forensic evidence. Homer Campbell, a forensic dentist, said that the 15 bite marks dotted across Brianna's body had come from at least two adults. However, he could not identify them because they were not distinct enough. Crime Lab analysts then testified that the test indicated that the blood found in Andy's underwear had come from baby Brianna. Supervising medical investigator Rebecca Irvine testified that Brianna had suffered skull, arm, leg, and rib fractures, and then she had sustained extensive bruising to her face, head, and genitals. After all of the testimony was presented, it was up to the jury to reach a verdict for all five family members. All five were found guilty of varying charges. Steve and Andy were found guilty of criminal sexual penetration, child abuse resulting in death, and other related charges. Stephanie was found guilty of negligent child abuse resulting in death and a lesser abuse charge. She was found not guilty of the intentional child abuse. Three relatives, including grandparents, were sentenced to 30 days in jail for failing to report the abuse. The maximum is 1 year. Gary Mitchell, the defense lawyer for Andy Walters, said that the mass prosecution was an injustice. Andy Walters was sentenced to 63 years in prison. Stephen Lopez was sentenced to 57 years in prison. Stephanie Lopez received just 26 years in prison and was released in 2016 on good behavior. Officer Wright has seen a lot during his career, but Brianna's case will haunt him for life. "I cried my eyes out. It will stay with me for the rest of my life. It tests you to the point where you're not sure you can speak. You're afraid that the emotion will take over." At the time Brianna was murdered, a person who committed intentional child abuse resulting in death faced a maximum of 18 years in prison. 18 years for life of a child? State Senator Mary Jane Garcia of Nevada, Anna said. "I thought it was absurd." It took 3 years of trying, but in 2005, Senate Bill 166, also known as Baby Brianna Bill, was officially signed into law by Governor Bill Richardson. The bill made child abuse which results in death a first-degree felony in New Mexico and set the mandatory minimum sentence at 30 years in prison. Thousands of people in the community wept over Brianna's horrific death. Mourners who never had the chance to meet Brianna in life came together for the baby girl in her afterlife. They paid for the casket and burial and claimed her body when nobody else did. Her gravesite became a memorial site with dozens of toys and flowers, something Brianna's family didn't approve of. Brianna's family and relatives didn't put one penny towards the child's funeral, burial, and gravestone. They didn't even claim her. The community did. Her family didn't want Brianna to receive love even after her death, and went out of their way to purchase a cage to go over the gravestone and attempt to shield her. The cage is a mess, unkept, and full of trash. The community refused to let Brianna and her story simmer, and still placed flowers around the cage. They also created another memorial site to visit and remember the little girl who never had a chance. When asked why they put a cage over Brianna's gravesite, Brianna's family had little to say. They were asked and they said they just wanted to be left alone, and they wanted Brianna to be left alone. Inside the cage is a cherub with a finger raised to her lips. Some believe it's a message from the family. Let's not talk about what's occurred here.
Welcome to my channel. This is Mr. Scary. Hope you enjoy the show.